It's the Friday after the primary, and now all the fun begins here at the Evening Edition Roundtable, the analysis of just what happened election night from two veteran journalists. Joining me is KPBS's senior Metro reporter, Allison St. John, and John Warren, editor and publisher of San Diego Voice and Viewpoint. Thank you both for being here. Allison, let's start with the mayor's race now. We see the fact that the top two, far right, far left, Carl DeMaio, Bob Filner, is that a statement somehow on our city?
Well, it's interesting because, you know, the city is 40% registered voters are Democrats and only 28% are Republicans, but DeMaio came out way ahead. And you've got to ask yourself whether perhaps the fact that the independent, the wild card, Nathan Fletcher, never quite managed to establish his identity for voters. They couldn't quite figure out enough where he stood and how he would vote on issues that mattered to them for them to vote for him, and so he came in third. It does look like we're back to the old Democrat-Republican face-off, in spite of the fact that this is supposed to be a nonpartisan race. You know, those two labels do represent some very different values.
And John, we often hear from the public, they're sick of the partisan politics, but are they really, or is this just sort of a statement on who comes out to vote in a primary?
It's just a cliche. It's a cliche because, I mean, when you look at the issues that were on the ballot this time, I think a big factor with DeMaio is the amount of time that he's put in as a council member with his various plans and ideas, and he was a driving force behind Prop B, and the people are tired of all of the issues with Prop B in terms of pension reform. It looks like you're not getting it. So we're in and out of court. It's not happening. They're not exactly in love with labor's image in terms of this whole issue, and then the Project Labor Agreement adds to it because it's kind of like this is a companion piece to just stop this madness. And so I think you have that's a greater issue from the public than the party identification of the two front runners.
Yes, and I agree with you. I think the fact that even although there are more Democratic voters in the city, this issue of the pension has raised such a lot of public passion that it's kind of superseded the party thing. People who would normally have voted perhaps with more labor issues are tired of the pension, and they're jealous of the pension, and they want to see that changed.
So, go ahead.
And it's very significant that in the days before, I didn't see a lot of attention given to this, but the gay community came out against Prop B because under the 401 pension approach, they would lose a lot of benefits because if it's a 401k plus Social Security, they will not be able to claim partnerships in terms of the federal component of the programs. And yet it still went forward. And so I think that's indicative of some of the issues that have not been addressed that people were concerned about, but they were more angry about the pension issue itself than this not being a perfect answer.
One wonders if there was enough time for that particular issue to gain traction. I remember that story. Katie Orr was reporting on that, and that was sort of towards the end of the campaign. Do you think it just didn't have enough time to?
I don't think it had enough time to gain traction, and I believe if it had gained traction, then it's a question of would it have taken votes from DeMaio and given them to DeMantis, but DeMantis was so far back, it clearly wouldn't have made much difference, so I guess.
Yeah, and I don't know whether San Diego voters realize how radical this particular pension initiative is. It's very different from the other pension reform initiative in California and San Jose, where it's more about changing the amount that public employees are contributing to their pension plans. This one really breaks the mold of public employee pensions by saying all new hires, except policemen, will get a 401k like the private sector style pension. So if voters had been given a different choice of perhaps, you know, like the San Jose voters had, all they wanted was pension reform, and the choice they got was 401ks. So that's what they voted
for. And a choice that we don't know whether it's legal still. I mean, it's subject to all kinds of court challenges. I want to move on a little bit to money. Kevin Crowe from Investigative News Source was here earlier, and he broke down the numbers for us in terms of how much money candidates spent divided by the number of votes. We ended up seeing some numbers. Carl DeMaio, $35 per vote. Bob Filner, $9. You know, does that surprise you, John, at all?
Well, no, I'm not surprised. I think Filner's strategy all along was that he would hold on to his money or whatever resources, and he was counting on name recognition and being the only Democrat in the race. DeMaio had an uphill battle because he already had labor against him, and he was concerned about how he was going to be positioned with some people downtown. But yet, the mayor, whom he, I guess, made peace with in terms of Prop B, had endorsed DeMantis, and so it's not surprising in terms of the way the money went and the fact that Filner didn't try to put more in because he really has made it clear he believes the money will be there as he moves toward November.
And that's certainly true. There's going to be a lot more money in November. I mean, Carl DeMaio, you've got to remember, he came from a background of working in Washington, D.C. I think a lot of his supporters are people back there who see that he is spearheading a reform that is very different from any kind of reform that's happening in any other city, and they want to see him succeed. Filner, of course, Congress, you know, they both have contacts in Washington, will almost certainly garner a lot of money from Democrats who are seeing that this city is representing the tip of the spear, in a sense, in terms of pension reform, among other issues.
Do you think, John, too, with the 52nd congressional race, that we're going to see a lot of federal super PAC money pouring into that one as well?
Well, I believe we will, because that race, while it's important to us in terms of personalities locally, the redrawn boundaries, I believe that when you consider the battle in the House for control, that seat under the redistricting is important to the Republicans in terms of trying to retain control, and it's important to the Democrats in terms of trying to regain control. So because of that, you're going to see lots of dollars come in on both sides. It's only a question whether it's going to be Peters or Saldana.
Yeah, and it's Brian Bilbray, of course, is a Republican incumbent. Well, we say incumbent, but the district is new, of course, and really a tight race between Peters and Saldana, though with Peters still slightly ahead of Saldana as they continue to count. Now, let's move on to the supervisor's race. Allison, tell us what was so interesting Tuesday night with that race.
Okay, so San Diego has finally, after, you know, almost two decades, got an open seat. One of the five supervisors, Pam Slater-Price, decided to step down. And now the two winners coming out of this primary are one Republican and one Democrat. So the Board of Supervisors has not seen a Democrat since the late 80s. It's been a long time. We had, in this particular primary, we had two Republicans, Steve Dannon, who was considered the front runner, and Carl Hilliard, who is the mayor of Del Mar. And you could say that one of their problems was they split the Republican vote, giving Dave Roberts, the Democrat, the chance to creep into second place. And now he is head-to-head, Dave Roberts and Steve Dannon. So it's going to be a very interesting race.
John, why is this significant if the makeup of the board changes? We knew that we going in, we had all Republicans. So what happens if you end up now with a Democrat and four Republicans?
Well, it's very interesting because this Democrat, if he's elected, or even if it's a Republican, they will come under the new term limits for the Board of Supervisors. So it's not like the five people have been there for 18 years. Now we're going to see a change. And it is believed that with that change is going to come some change in terms of the attitude. It's been a very conservative entity with the five. I mean, they've held very tightly together the million-dollar discretion fund for each, and the manner in which they've divvied things up, and the fact that they've been financially sound has played a major role. But I think what helps Dave Roberts in this scenario is the fact that Pam Slater-Price, Republican, has crossed over and endorsed him as a Democrat, and I think that's going to add to the interest.
And Steve Dannon has cast himself as somebody who would make a big change and come in and get rid of the so-called slush fund that the supervisors have. But actually, he, if anything, is more conservative or as conservative as the rest of the board, so he's likely to ripple the waters less than if Dave Roberts, the Democrat, got in.
And I do want to add, though, when he was on the show and he said he would get rid of the slush fund, I did ask him, if you can't convince the other supervisors to get rid of it, will you take it? And he said yes. So we should add that
as
well.
It's more symbolic than anything else.
Well, it only takes three of them, three out of five for the majority, so it's not like he's got to get a unanimous vote. He just needs two other people to come along and say, which way will you go?
Not a lot of time left, Allison, but tell us about what happened in Oceanside over rent control.
Well, the rent control was a bit of a David and Goliath issue. You had five times as much money raised by the park owners as by the mobile homeowners, and yet the mobile homeowners prevailed with 65% of the vote. It was a very hotly campaigned issue. There were people out on the streets in Oceanside waving banners, and a lot of mailers. I mean, I got more than two dozen mailers just for that one issue alone. So it really was a hot issue, and I think it shows that the people of Oceanside still care about the veterans and the seniors who are finding a little oasis of affordable housing still. And even although it was only phasing out rent control, it would have affected the value of their homes, and so the measure went down.
Well, you guys have been great, Allison St. John and John Warren, and I do want to send people also to our website, kpbs.org, where they can listen to a much longer conversation with none other than Gloria Penner and the two of you. Thank you both for being here.
Thank you, Joanne.
Thank you.